If you are good, oh, oh, you are good, oh, oh, you are good, oh, oh, you are good, oh, oh,
oh, oh.
Let all the other things fade away until there's only darkness fade away. Let all the other things fade away. Until there's only you, let all the other things fade away. King Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. King Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. King Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. King Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. And you stand the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in.
Yeah.
together for my good.
God, that you loved us so much that you died for us. God, I'm never going to really grasp that, but thank you that you did it, God. Thank you that you sent your Spirit to be with us and guide us. Thank you that there is no condemnation because we believe in you. Thank you for who you are and what you're going to do to me.
Morning,
church.
We are here to pray together, and I really like the prayer session because as church, Damascus Road is really a praying church, and we are not just coming together to be together and to hear about the message, but also to lift each other up in our prayers. So let us be united in prayer. God, thank you so much for who you are. Oh God, we love you so much. And thank you for your goodness. Thank you for a new day today. Thank you that the sun shines today, and thank you that we could be here together. God, really, words is not enough to describe how thankful we are. Maybe it sounds really Christian when we say, God, you are good. But it's something that we experience each day. That God, you are really good. You're good all the time in our lives. And we are really nothing without you. And we want to come as a church together to bring these thanks that people say to you. I only have one card. But yeah, that thank you that we can be grateful and thank you for other things, even small things in life. I just want to pray for this person. This person thanks you for a new job that this person has. And thank you for health in their families, and also that they experience miracles all the time. God, thank you for this person. Thank you that you, give him or this person a new job. Thank you, God, that you care. You care about this family, you care about all of us. And thank you so much, God, for providing in their needs, providing in this new job. I just want to pray, God, that this person will be blessed, also be a blessing. Wherever you put this person in the place, in the new place, I pray that this person may, can adapt really quick to this new job. May you bless this person in everything that this person does. And also thank you, God, that you give help to their family. And then they experience miracles each day again. Because God, you God that perform miracles. And we're thankful. We are so thankful, God. Help us as church also to grow towards you. To grasp and to realize how good you are. And how deep your love is for us all. Thank you so much, God. In your mighty name we pray.
Father, thank you that you remain the same. Yesterday, today, and tomorrow, Father, you are always the same. You are a faithful God, and you are a providing God, a miracle-working God. Father, thank you that we can look back at the past and see everything that you've done in our lives, everything that you've done in the lives of others. Lord, and if you do it for others, you also do it for those that are today coming to you with requests for prayer, Father. Lord, would you provide in their needs? Father, I'd like to pray for Laura, who says that she explicitly received death threats. Father, there's a situation going on in her life that is very sophisticated, very challenging, Father. And we pray for wisdom for Laura, Father. We pray that you guide her every step. Father, that you give her the wisdom to take the right decisions and how to deal with this situation. So that the relationship with this person, whoever it may be, that is giving these death threats, Father, that it may be restoration in that relationship, that this person may come to his senses and experience the love of Christ through the life of Laura, so that this may stop. Father, we pray for your divine protection upon the life of Laura. Father, that nothing harmful may come her way, Father, but that she may walk in your presence in everything she does. Father, give her peace in her heart, knowing that you are there right with her in everything that she does. Lord, and let her focus be on you throughout everything and not on the problems. In Jesus' name we pray. Lord, and we also pray for young Derek, who says he has a heart condition. He's asking for clarity and for full healing. Father, and as we learned last week in the preaching of last week, it's not just our physical heart that is important, but also our spiritual heart. Father, we pray that through this condition, through all of these circumstances, young Derek may be strengthened also in his spiritual heart. Father, that his heart may be right before you, that he may enjoy your presence. Father, you are a God who never works halfway. And so we pray for healing in his physical heart, and we pray for healing in his spiritual heart, so that in everything he can enjoy his relationship with you, and he can be joyful no matter the circumstances. That he can give thanks in all circumstances, God. And thank you for the work that you are doing in his life, Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, I want to pray for the father of Emma, who for the third time in his life has prostate cancer. Father, you've been healing him twice before. Don't let it stop here, Father, but continue to work in his life. Father, we pray that through this process he may be drawn closer to you, that he may truly know your love, and he may truly know you for who you are, and that he may put you first in his life. Father, I pray that he puts his trust in you and not in the first place in doctors or medication or treatments. Father, because you are our healer. And doctors and medication and all these things, they are just tools in your hand, Father. So we pray that you do a mighty work in his life. And that in all things, you give him peace in his heart, Father. Knowing that you are right there with him. Father, and lastly, we want to pray for the family of a student that recently passed away. Father, we pray that you comfort the family that is left behind. Father, that you give them peace and strength in this difficult time. Father, help them to process this time of loss, to give it a place in their heart, knowing that you are always in control, knowing that you can turn even the worst situations into good for those that you love. Father, would you break through with your healing power and with your wisdom and with your love so that this family may be comforted in these difficult times. Father, we pray that even in these hard times, that they may find reasons to be thankful. That they may, rather than looking at the loss, they may look at the memories that they share and be thankful for the time that they did have together. Thank you for who you are, Father. Thank you that you are a loving God. Thank you that we can always put our trust in you, knowing that you will never fail us, knowing that you will never forsake us. Because your love remains forever. Your love is unfailing. Thank you for who you are. And thank you that we can freely come to you. In Jesus' name we pray.
And as you know, we just came back on a mission trip to Indonesia like 2 weeks ago, and we put together a nice video for you to see about the mission trip, so enjoy.
You reached out.
nice and cozy.
Yes.
We have plenty of space.
We have
This is the first mission trip to Alma, but not the last. So come and join.
Yeah, man.
It's our wife's ministry. So we
and nice cookies.
Like Judith said, join us next year.
Yes.
Yes.
Package team. We're handing out every month food packages for people who need support. We do practical work and we are listening here, and above all we also pray for them, and we want to show them the love of Jesus through that. And today I would like to share my own food package story, because not so long ago I also received a food package. And I want to start with Jeremiah 29, verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And that's actually one of my favorite Bible verses. And I haven't been raised up in financial poverty. I raised up in a big house with a big car. Both my parents were head of a primary school. We had a lot of holidays, we had a lot of luxury food and wine, but there was so much spiritual and emotional poverty. There was a lot of brokenness, there was violence, mental abuse, addiction, most of the time hidden, adultery and divorces. And that causes a lot of pain and unhappiness. So as a kid and a youngster, I was surviving. I managed to get a bachelor degree and start living on my own, but I was not managed to get into healthy relationships. And when I became a Christian at 29 years old, I thought God would give me a healthy marriage because we both knew Jesus. But it ended in the same level of brokenness as I raised up. But there was a lot of financial debt, and one time I was pregnant from my firstborn. I was alone because my ex-husband was in a Christian addiction of a Christian clinic. And I prayed to God, what a mess. What a mess. How can I give my children a good future? And it was in the middle of the night, and then God spoke to me and God told me, they will have my provision. Don't worry, they will have my provision. So when my ex-husband came back, I thought everything went upwards, but soon it went again downwards. And he made so many debts, and I was so worried and stressed out. Once I could not even pay the rent, and I had a lot of sleepless nights. I felt stressed. Above all, I felt so ashamed. For my family, for my surrounding. I felt embarrassed, I felt guilty, and I also had my proudness, because I wanted to fix it on my own, I wanted to get it done well. So that was the time when I really started surrendering more, praying more to God, and the provision came. Bernard and Marijke from this church started giving me groceries. A lot of them were diapers, and it was just what I needed. When I needed clothes, I started praying, God, would you give me clothes? And then suddenly somebody else from the church came with clothes. One time I didn't have fruit to give to my children, and I wanted to have them healthy food. So in the morning I started praying for fruit, and when I came back from work, there was fruit at the door. He even gave us a car. A free car from my brother. He just said, hey, you can have my car so I can travel the babies, the little children that we had around. When we had such a high bills,
somebody from church gave me an envelope and said, I just got on my heart to give me an envelope. And they even got a big fridge. And the fridge was no single, it was every single day filled with food. And that was God's provision. I had three jobs, two jobs in social care, and one was cleaning houses. And I said, God, I want to help people too, but I don't have enough. And God told me, you have enough. You have enough. Just start sharing. So I take a step out of faith, because, I mean, we had so much debt, but I took a step out of faith, and I start sharing the food. I opened my closet, the clothes which I didn't wear, I just gave away, and I just did what God was saying to me. And I see something happening. I see also something happening in my heart, in my faith. Out of my own protection and protection of my children, I needed to divorce in 2015. And my brother and I start sorting out the financial debts, and it was more than 41,000 euro. And I was married in a community of property. So the half of the debt was mine. But I didn't cause the debt. So I stopped praying and I said, God, I need your righteousness. I need your righteousness. And I prayed and prayed. And a miracle happened, because in the court, I got debt free. So my children and I could start over again, and that was the turning point. And then God gave me so much. He gave me one job. He gave a financial provision in 1.5 years. I even had money to go on mission trip with my kids to go to Albania. My work is now paying a study, which gives me more opportunity. And I also had, and also God gave me a healthy, loving, caring, and warm, and supportive relationship. And he has so much store. He has so much store for everyone. And the learning point which I have is, don't take anything for granted. I'm so happy every night when I lay in my bed. I don't take it for granted that I have a bed that's warm and dry. I don't take it for granted when I see my kids sleeping. You know, it's such a blessing that God gave children. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful for everything, for the church we have, for the freedom. God gave me so much thankfulness. And I'm also able to support other women who are in the same position what I had, you know, and God is expanding. And I just want to give this message that it can happen to anyone. It can happen to anyone. And a journalist, Sander Kramer, he wrote a book, From Millionaire to Paperboy. And he shared in his book a story about a professor and a multimillionaire who is homeless, who's living on the streets now. But they're facing so multiplied problems that he couldn't handle it, and ended up in the street. Educated people, you know, from Syria, from Iraq, they needed to flee. They had their own house, they had shops, and they needed to flee with nothing, you know, and they needed to start all over again. And they're living here in Maastricht. It could be your neighbor in the street, it could be your classmate, which you don't know, or even the person who's sitting next to you right now, because once I was sitting also there next to you, and I just keep a smile on my face, and nobody saw my shame. So that's the reason why food packages exist, you know, for Maastricht. And if you want to help other people, if you want to help your classmate or your brother or sister, or the one who's God's shown you in prayer, then you can help. You can help by donating food items, non-perishable food items. You can become a volunteer. You can donate monthly, financial. You can donate once. And you can be a contact person for that person and have a friendship. And we have a waiting list now. We need to say no to people, because people start knowing food package from Damascus Road, and we need to say no, we have a waiting list because of the money and the volunteers. So I hope you do receive the message, and I know God's provision is big for everyone and also for the people in need in Maastricht. I want to end this with the last Bible verse. The king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." And that's the base, you know. If you're interested in a flyer, you can come after the service and I can give you one with further details. Thank you for listening.
The university students will have a real great event after the service, so please don't walk away. So many people created so many yummy things, and after church you can buy these things, and the money is there to help people going on a breakaway. But there is not only yummy food, also the drum. Leaded by Tom, they created some music tracks, and these tracks can be downloaded, and also that money goes to the breakaway event. So if you're interested, please contact Tom over here. Thank you, Tom. So for the drum breakaway, just a few days ago, because the event will take place from the 3rd till the 5th of November, and there are only a few spots left, so the sign up for the event ends on the 1st of November, so please join. Then we have also upcoming Serve the City events. The first event will take place at the 4th of November on the Saturday from 9:30 to 5 o'clock. And for this event, we need volunteers to help with practical work. And for this event, you can talk to Albert Mangami sitting in the back over there. Yeah, thank you all. Then we have the second event. It's the Cross the Line Community Potluck Dinner on Saturday the 18th from 5 till 8 p.m. So invite people to join for the dinner or prepare a dish. People can also volunteer to help serving food, look after the kids and clean up. And for this event, you can talk to Ashna and Lucille. I don't know if both of them are here right now. Okay. So, last thing we have is the Drum Fellowship Night, and that will take place at the St. Peterstraat 6, and will be on Wednesday at 7:30. That's all.
One of the reasons why I'm grateful that we have the children in here today with us is because I hope it shows you the value of workers and what they do with children. And part of why I say that is because one of the women, among many men and women that have been very helpful with it, but one of those women who's been here for a while, this is her last Sunday with us. So Kavita, if you would come forward, we want to take the opportunity to recognize you, thank you, let you say some words if you'd like, and then obviously get to pray with you as well. So Kavita, please come and please give her a round of applause.
I think most of you know me. I've been in Maastricht, I think, now for 6 years. And I think the second Sunday I was here, I already joined Damascus Road. And I think a couple of months in, I started with the kids' ministry. I've had a lovely time. I really enjoy being with the kids. And honestly, they've given me more than I've given them. So, and the same goes for all of you. So thank you.
Kavita was also part of our leaders group of the kids' church, so she is really going to be missed a lot. She was my leader before I became her leader, so it's a bit funny to see her going now. But anyone who has known Kavita during this period, feel free to stand up and come and help us pray and pray a blessing over her. So you're all welcome to join us. Heavenly Father, I am very grateful for Kavita's life and everything that she has done for this church, Father. Even though she was always quiet, Father, but she did things in the secret nobody knows, Lord. Father, I pray that you may remember her and all her needs. Father, she has been often challenged with work and the children and the husband who has to work, Father, but I'm just grateful for the investment and the commitment she made to serving kids ministry, Father. Now that she goes away to Tilburg, I pray that you would also bless her with a great church over there, Lord Jesus. I pray that you would give them peace and rest as they are trying to settle in Tilburg and start up this new their lives again in another city, Lord. Father, I also pray for their children. May they not be destabilized by the changes, Father, but that everything may go smoothly, Lord Jesus. Father, we just pray a blessing over her, but also over her mother, who often helped Kavita while she was here, Father. Would you pray the, bless the whole family, Lord Jesus? I thank you, and I lift her up again into your hands. I'm very thankful for her life, and she's going to be missed. Father, would you also please try to fill the void that she's going to leave in Kids Ministry, Father, and leadership. We trust you that you will take care also of the Kids Ministry. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hi, everyone. My name is Blaise, and this morning I'm doing the Bible reading. As some of you know, our church is studying the book of Luke. So the scriptures that I will read today come from Luke. Chapter 14 and 15, and only there on the screen. So, one Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this person your seat. Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Then Jesus said to his host, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. So this weekend, when Becky asked me to do the Bible reading, and when I saw the verses, I was really amazed, because I was meditating on something during this week, and God was speaking to me personally, and he gave me that verse in Romans chapter 12, verse 3, where Paul is saying, to not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. And also in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, where he says, value others above yourself. This week, there have been people I avoided, because I thought, I prefer to be with some other friends, because I just don't want to be with them. And when I was reading these verses, I realized that sometimes Jesus is sending us to the people we see as not valuable. But Jesus is sending us to the poor, to the crippled, to the lame, to the blind. Maybe not physically, but also people who need our help. People who need to receive God's love as well. And when I saw these verses, for me, it really spoke to me. And I pray that this morning, as God is speaking through to his word, that you will also see the people around you that maybe you have been avoiding, the people who are you have been thinking they are not valuable, but if God is putting them around you, it's because He knows that they also need love. So may God bless you.
We have been going through the Gospel of Luke, following in Jesus' steps. And my hope is that you're being a little challenged as we go. We say that our church's motto is to love as Jesus loved, to teach what Jesus taught, and obey as Jesus obeyed. And I hope that as you're looking at Jesus as we go through the book of Luke, that you're maybe reconsidering, what is His type of love, and how do I live that way? What did He truly teach, and how do I also express those truths to others, and how do I live out an obedient life? And today I hope they'll be the same. I am an American, so I realize when I'm speaking to a crowd that's from many different nations, I have to be careful. And two of the things I most often try to avoid are sports and politics. But sometimes when I'm with my friends, if they ask me a direct question about politics, I'll discuss it. And one of my friends, who's from a non-Western country, had asked me my thoughts on a specific American politician and why some Americans, what they thought about this person. And I had said that they had recently been shown that they had lied about a certain topic, and that many people didn't trust that person because of lying. And my friend responded to me, "So, why is that a problem?" Now, the problem was that they got caught lying. And at first, that seemed very strange to me, but as I've thought about it later, I've begun to see that some of that has to do with culture clash, being from different cultures. Now, I'm someone who I find personality studies interesting, things like the love languages, but another one of those interesting sociological things is this idea of cultures, and especially innocent guilt cultures versus honor shame cultures. And we can't completely separate them. There'll be bits of those probably in just about every culture we have, but which one is predominant? So in my situation, that specific politician, I grew up in an innocent guilt culture. I think of, well, what's right, what's wrong, the person lied, thus guilty. But for the person who's from a more honor-shame culture, it wasn't so much did they follow the rules, but getting caught, because all politicians lie, it was just the problem that they got shown it, would have been that was the shame part. And so that the shame was the issue more than the guilt. These ideas can take a little bit of getting used to. In short, I am not an expert to explain all of it, but in short, innocence guilt cultures will look often at rules. And do you follow rules? Whereas honor shame focus more on relationships and honor and shame that are given inside of relationships. It's not just separate from like these separate rules. So when I had a friend who was in Western Europe for the first time, and I asked, "Oh, how was your time? What did you think of it here?" The thing that struck him the most was that people actually stopped at stoplights. He had driven with me in late enough at night. We come to a red stoplight. There's no cars coming. There's no bicycles. There's no walkers. There's nothing. I could drive through and know that I wasn't going to cause any problems. There's no police cameras there. But I stop, because that's the rule. And for him, that was, oh, this is different than what comes in my culture. Some of that can be seen in other ways. Innocence guilt cultures are normally seen as very individualistic. So let's take a politician again. If a politician does something stupid in my country, a very common response is, "I didn't vote for him." See, I'm not guilty. It's their fault. It's not on me. But in some other countries, if a politician does something, they feel bad because it makes the whole country look bad. Whether or not they like that politician, it can be shameful for the whole country, not, "Well, that's not my fault because I didn't vote for them." Money can be seen differently from these cultures as well. Innocence guilt culture will often think, "What's fair? I worked hard for this money, this is mine." Honor shame cultures are known for being much more generous. and ones that will give, and they see I have to take care of not even just immediate family like my parents, but will then also be helpful to uncles and aunts or second and third cousins, because that would be an honorable thing to do. And if you shame someone, that shames you in a way. If you honor them, that honors you as well. Sometimes we use those parts of our cultures in bad ways, honestly, and come up with our own sorts of excuses for things. Real life examples of if a young woman who is not married gets pregnant, in an innocent guilt culture, they might say, you should abort that child because it wouldn't be fair to the child to be put into the situation of this family. It wouldn't be fair to the mother to have to put up with her life completely changing for the rest of her life because of this one night. And in innocent guilt cultures, we'll think about what's fair. Whereas in honor-shame culture, I've seen it where a Christian family has told their daughter to have an abortion because of the shame that it would bring on their family if other people found out what had happened. Unfortunately, I think both of those sides miss the idea of the inherent worth that God has put into people. He has put His image upon them and the honor that we are supposed to give to life. But those show a bit of how, through various parts of culture, we're affected, even sometimes when we don't get it. Now, as I said, I am not an expert on it. And I'm trying to learn. I say that in part because I know in this church there have been so many people who have honored me from various cultures. And it would be hard for me, probably impossible for me to name them all. Whether that's someone like Esther, or someone like Blaise and Emma, or any guy with the name of Patrick in this church, or Tom, or the other Tom, or the Christofiaks, or the Koymans, or name the next person sitting next to you in this church, Willem and Judith, so many, and I can't say them all, Sandy, Kher, Shinshin, many people have stopped to honor me or to honor Christine, and I know there have been times where I have not received it well, and I haven't always given honor in return. For anyone who's ever tried to call me pastor as a way of honoring me, and I just kind of shrugged it off, I'm sorry. On the flip side, I know that there have been times where I thought I was doing right by my culture, but I shamed other people without even realizing it. And maybe it's not my fault. Or maybe I should have known better as I've been working among a group like this. I can at least say I wish I would have known better. So if there had been a time with you where I did not honor you or I shamed you, I apologize. Because I realize I don't come from a culture that is as strong in that and understand it as well. And I have not been perfect with that. But why do I say all of that? First, to apologize and to thank you for your patience. But also because I'm hoping to further this discussion, because why does this matter? Especially when it comes to Jesus. Because Jesus worked, lived, taught, spoke, obeyed, loved inside a predominantly honor-shame culture. That's what he grew up in. That's what he saw. And so if we can understand that a little better, which for some people, you automatically get it. For others, it's foreign to you. But if we can understand that, that helps us when we read the Bible. Secondly, I think it's important to at least understand a bit of these dynamics because most of the people in the world have grown up in a predominantly honor-shame culture. Three of the four most populated countries are definitely honor-shame cultures over innocence guilt cultures. So, in this room, there's a good chance that more people are from that than are not. And even if it's an even mix, it's good for us to be able to start that conversation and understand each other. So I hope that when we come to the Bible and when we come to Jesus, we'll be able to look with a little different perspective. And that's what I'm hoping to do today, is to open your mind to the Bible in a different way, especially if you're from a strongly innocence guilt culture, to see the themes of honor and shame in the Bible. So we'll start in the Old Testament, because the themes of honor and shame are there from beginning to end. In the creation narrative, when God makes humanity,
You know what he does to them first? He honors them. He said, I want to make someone in my own image, and to give his face, to give his name, to give his stamp, someone is honoring them. Before he has given a single rule, before he has tried to talk to them about innocence or guilt, he honors humanity. That's the first thing that we see God doing. And when Adam and Eve are made, we're told that they stand with each other, they're naked, and they are unashamed. Now, after humanity sins and makes a mistake, here's what we're told that they do. They hide, and we're not told that they feel guilty. We're told hid because we were ashamed. Because they're thinking not just in rules, they're thinking in relationship. And they were ashamed. If we fast forward to what would seem like one of the most innocent guilt things in the Bible, the Ten Commandments. It's a set of rules. It's the laws, right? But what's the first commandment with a promise? Honor your father and mother. It will go well with you if you do that. And if we look through the other commandments, honor is a large part of that. Why would God say, don't take the Lord's name in vain? That has to do with honor. Or putting other gods before him, that has to do with honor. Or not committing adultery, that's showing honor towards a neighbor or not, and some of those things. So even in those moments, if we look through the prophets and so much of what they say, often we see this recurring theme of God saying, I'm doing this for my name, I'm doing this for my glory, for my honor. And all of these show an honor mentality, that is a big deal. Now we fast forward to the life of Jesus. Some of the things that we might not see of why some of these actions Jesus did were so big is if we miss how honor and shame plays into that. As we go through the book of Luke, we come across it several times. Even just in the genealogy of Jesus, the fact that they want to say that Jesus comes from this honorable line. Jesus is from the line of King David. He's from the line of Abraham, who's this great father, and he has others that are in this line. And for an honor-shame culture, it's important to know where you came from, because that explains a lot about whether you're born into honor or born into shame. And they're trying to show that already in Jesus' life. Now, Jesus starts honoring people in strange ways when he chooses fishermen who are not especially well-educated and a tax collector who is not very well-loved by most of his countrymen to come be his pupils. To come be his students, because especially for a rabbi, the more important people you had following you, the more important you looked. But Jesus chose ones that weren't seen as important by the people around him, because he wanted to honor them. When Jesus gives his sermon on the plain, we've heard perhaps of the Beatitudes, when he says, blessed are the poor, blessed are the weak, blessed are those. And the Greek word, makarios, is often seen as like, oh, it's talking about happiness. But a little hint, Jesus wasn't speaking Greek at the time. We just had that translated. There's a good chance that word blessed would have come from an Aramaic word that had in its underpinnings the idea of honored. Honored are the poor. Honored are those who are persecuted. And Jesus shows that. He lives that in various ways. Anytime when he heals someone, whether that's a bleeding woman who would have been shamed by her culture for that, whether it's healing a leper who was an outcast, which is a deep, deep shame, whether it's someone who is disfigured, who wouldn't have been allowed because of their shame into certain parts of the temple, anytime Jesus does a miracle of healing someone's life, he's honoring them in a very special way. He's restoring to them an honor that he already believes they have. When Jesus, in Luke chapter 7, goes to an honored host's house that tries to shame Jesus, whereas there's this shameful woman who wants to honor Jesus, we see the way Jesus reacts, and that's honor and shame. In Luke chapter 12, when Jesus says, if you acknowledge me before men, I'll acknowledge you before my Father in heaven. If you disown me, I'll disown you. This is an idea of if you honor me, I honor you back. If you shame me, there's shame that comes in return. And there's that picture of honor and shame that's going on. In Luke chapter 13, when we're told about people taking their place at the feast in God's kingdom. Jesus is speaking about, you can eat at the table together, that's an honor picture. And he says the first will be last, and the last will be first. Those have to do with honor and shame. So today, I want us to look at those verses we read from Luke chapter 14 and 15 to see what does Jesus say to people who are struggling with shame? And what does Jesus say to people who are struggling with honor? We'll start with that one. In Luke 14, Jesus goes to a dinner. He's been invited. He's being honored, at least in some way. And we're told that while he's sitting there, he's watching how people are trying to get the best seats in the house. They want to sit in the good spot. They want to have the reserved seating that's at the front. So Jesus tells the story. If you're invited to a wedding feast, here's what you should do. If you try to put yourself in the best seat, maybe someone more important will come along and you'll get kicked out of your seat and you'll look ridiculous. Whereas if you choose to humble yourself first and someone else honors you, then you'll be honored in front of others. Jesus knew that so many people at his time, and I know that so many people today, live their lives trying to honor themselves. We fight for our honor. And Jesus is trying to say, humility is the way to go. Let someone else be the one who honors you. Proverbs says something similar. Let another tongue boast about you, honor you, and not yourself. For those who are so intent upon their own honor, Jesus would say, that should not be your primary concern. Yes, we want to live honorable lives, and it's good that we do so. But to get other people to give us honor often has to do with us stepping on other people or getting higher on the list or making sure that I have this seat so someone else has to take another seat. And Jesus said, that's not what I came to do. And so, may we be people who are willing to put our honor aside. And Jesus is honest. If you want to follow him, it will cost your striving for honor. But are you willing to consider that cost? Because Jesus tells us to do that first. He said, if you want to follow me, you're going to have to set your honor aside. But don't start doing it until you've taken time to count the cost. Otherwise, you might complete only the foundation before running out of money, and then everyone would laugh at you. He's making this picture. He talks about building up a tower. Sorry, I didn't give you that framework. But he says, if you want to follow me, it's like someone building a tower. Don't start until you know you can finish it. Because if you just get started and you don't end it, people are going to make fun of that. When I lived in the Virgin Islands, there was a bridge that was called the Bridge to Nowhere, because it connected to absolutely nothing on either side. At one point, someone built a bridge, the government paid for it, and it does absolutely nothing. And we all made fun of it. Because someone started, but there wasn't an ending that had a good point to it. And in your life, if you want to follow Jesus, know that there will be times where that costs you your honor, and count that cost first. Do you think it's going to be all about, I follow Jesus so I can get in the limelight? Think again. And be willing to set that aside. But then, we come to Luke chapter 15, and that starts with the men that he was first eating with. Now he's gone to eat with sinners and tax collectors, with these people that are not respected. Jesus is willing to eat with the honored. He's willing to eat with the shamed, but the honorable people said Jesus is going to eat with all these shameful people. So Jesus, as usual, starts to tell a story. He tells three stories about a lost sheep, about a lost coin, and then a third one that's sometimes referred to as the prodigal or the lost son or the two sons, the two lost sons that we'll see in this picture. But you may have heard that story before. If you're not used to looking at a bit through an honor-shame way. I hope you listen with that. There's a man who had two sons. The younger son came to his father and said, "Father, give me my inheritance now." The father did so. And so the son takes the money. Likely there would have been land involved, and it sounds like he sold off the family land, which, if you're from certain cultures, you would understand better. The land of your family, the land of your forefathers, you don't just sell that away. That's a very shameful thing to just give away that land. But this young man has just gone for the money, and then he goes off to a distant land where he spends it on loose living, on wild women, on drinking a lot, and all these other things. Now, from my innocence guilt perspective, I'll typically think about all the bad things he's done. This young son has been out sleeping around with people, and he's been getting drunk, and he's been doing all these things. And I'm not saying that that's not part of what we should see, but much more, the people listening to him would have heard how shamefully the son had acted to the father. How everyone else in the village would have looked at that father. One, the father actually, your son asked for this crazy request and you did it? What kind of stupid dad are you? And then once he gets the money, he does all these shameful things and you don't step in. And then after that, the way he lives after that, he loses all of his money, he squanders all that you had. It would be seen as so shameful to the dad. And at least for a while, the son does not realize how shameful it is to himself. But then there's a famine, and then the money runs out, and then he goes from being the big partier that everybody loves to have around to the guy who's struggling to find a job and ends up finding what would have been considered this incredibly shameful job, feeding pigs who are the shameful animal, and you're having to feed them. I once worked in a cat food repackaging plant. I am not a deep lover of cats. So to consider the fact that most of my day was spent taking cat food from one box just so that it could be put into a prettier box for cats who will not care about the box. It was a good learning experience in my life. I am grateful that my parents encouraged me to have jobs that were not always seen as the honorable jobs. But even cat food or packaging would be better than being starving and trying to feed pigs who don't care about you and they're getting food and you're getting nothing. So he finally realizes how his life has ended up in utter shame. And he decides, even my dad's servants, even though they're the lowest on the rung at home, they get treated better than this. And there's something about his father's mercy that he must believe in. And that'll be hopefully an important thing for you today, is to ask yourself whether you believe that the God who created you is a God of mercy. Because this young son says, "I'll go back to my dad. And I'll tell him, I'm sorry, this was all my fault. Don't even take me back as a son. Treat me like a servant." But to even have that little glimmer of hope, after all he has done to shame his dad. But he must know his dad well enough to believe that his father has at least a little mercy out there for him. And it's worth going a long way and going back to a city where he knows everyone is watching him to at least give it a shot. A short side note. One of the first times when I met the woman who would become my wife, we were at a wedding, and there was dancing, and I asked her to dance with me. Because I was the new guy in town, and no one knew me, and so what if I looked like an idiot on the dance floor? No one would care. But this was the church she grew up in, people had known her for decades. So she wasn't willing to dance with me, because she knew everyone was watching. You know the end of the story is I get married. It's a great story. But to maybe help you see a little bit the idea of everyone is watching. The son knows when he goes back to town, everyone is watching. And he's not showing up nearly as proud as he was when he walked out. He's not showing up nearly as happy or as well-dressed. He doesn't have money to say, ha, you guys don't understand how good my life's going to be. And he shows up, and Jesus says that while he was still a long way off, the Father sees him and runs to him. Again, in an honor-shame culture, an old man doesn't need to run. Not only doesn't need to run, it looks bad if you run. You're having to put forth effort. People should run to you because you're important enough for them to come to you. But this father, who has been shamed so deeply, sees his shameful son. And he probably knows that people are going to be talking about the son anyway. So he gives him something else to talk about. Not the shame of his son, but the shame of his father, this old man running through the streets to convey honor back to the shamed one. And once he gets there, the son has his speech all ready. I don't know if you're the type of person that like runs over and over in your head something that you want to say to someone. I can be that way. You hope you get it out right. And so the son is probably nervous, but saying, Dad, I'm sorry, I've sinned against you, and I'm... And the dad shuts him up. It gets too exciting. The dad is just saying, servants, get here. We have to put a robe on him. He probably looks bad. He probably smells bad. But instead, he's been given a robe. And we have to put a ring on his finger. And we're going to have a party. You know what you do at a party? You invite people to it. This father is saying, I am inviting people. I am showing you intentional honor. And I don't feel bad showing the city that I honor you. And if he's going to honor them, it'll make it a whole lot harder for the others to shame the young man. And so the son is brought back in, and the one that felt shamed gets restored. But there's this older son that we haven't heard a whole lot about in the story up until now, except that he was there. We're told when the son, the older son, who was working out in the fields, who was being a good boy, comes back and finds out that there's a party, and that this party is for his shameful little brother, he gets mad. And he won't enter the house. And the father comes out to him, saying, please, come in. Now again, from an innocence guilt culture, the thing that we try to see is how prideful this young man is. Because we're trying to, like, what did he do wrong? He stayed with dad, he worked in the field, all these things. He did them right. He's just prideful. I guess that's how he's guilty. And I'm not saying that's not part of it, but the fact that he wouldn't go into the house is that he's shaming his dad. An oldest son should be there to greet guests. Some of you are from cultures where you would get that much quicker than I would. That the oldest son is the one who's supposed to be welcoming people, is supposed to be greeting people, that there's something special about being the oldest son. And this oldest son is, I'm not going to do that. He's trying to shame his younger brother, and he's shaming his dad right now. That's what he's doing wrong. And dad comes out to say, please, come into the house. He says, no, uh-uh. Listen to me first. You give this little twerp half of the money, he goes off, lives this crazy way. I have stayed here, I have worked for you, I have been a good boy, I have done everything right. He would be a perfect innocence guilt person. And he's like, I am innocent, I have done it right. I have kept every rule. And you never even gave me a little goat for me to throw a party for my friends. Not everyone in the city knows that you want to honor me, but they know that you sure want to honor that little kid. And that sort of response is him being very shaming to his dad. But what's the dad doing? See, the dad runs out to the younger son. He runs out to the older son. He is continuously going to us. Whether we feel like we deserve all the honor or whether we feel like we're so incredibly shameful, the father is running out to meet us and asking us to come in and asking us to be a part of the celebration. He is wanting to give honor. Not always the honor that we want to have, though. whether today you feel like you've been ashamed of yourself or whether you feel like you've done everything perfect, know that there's a God in heaven who deserves all the honor that we could give him, and one way or another, we honestly haven't. That was something that I've also had to learn in my life and how to interact with some friends. When I was in university, I had some friends that were from India. I grew up in a mostly Hindu background, and I remember trying to share this great story of Jesus' life with them and how this was really good news, that from all the sins that we've done, we can be forgiven. All the guilt that we had, we can be made innocent. And as I tried to explain this to him, I said, "Do you understand that you've sinned?" "No." "No, like you've sinned, everybody sins." "I haven't sinned." "Okay, maybe you didn't understand. Like, you've never done anything wrong." "No, never." "Like, even as a little kid, you didn't, like, talk back, you didn't steal candy from the store, you didn't punch your little brother, anything?" "No, I've never done anything wrong." There are two possible ways, both could be real, of what was going on. Either one, from an honor-shame mentality, he's not going to say, "I was shameful." So he'll continue to think that he did right. But I think the other one might be as or more likely to be true, that he truly believed that from his culture, what he had done had always been right. He had been an honor to the family. The fact that he was able to be studying to be a medical doctor around the world, he had maybe been the good son that deserved honor and had lived with that honor and had shown honor to his family. And instead of having this idea that I'm always guilty, maybe he truly believed that he had not sinned, because that wasn't even really a part of his mentality. And I wish I had understood then how to explain that there is a God who deserves more honor than any of us have given him. No matter how nice of a life you've lived, he deserves more honor than that. He deserves all of our attention. He deserves all of our time. He deserves us to give him everything and more that we can. All the best of the words that we can say, all the best gifts that we could give, all of the best attention that we could. And part of living in an honor culture is that you're supposed to honor your benefactor to other people. And if we have not been taking our time telling others about the goodness of this God who has given us everything, then we're not showing him all of the honor that he really deserves. No matter how good you've been, we've been one of the two sons that shamed our father. And yet he still wants to show us honor. I'm not trying to make you hungry, but I do have one more story about a banquet. And then there's the bake sale afterwards. Please feel free to go. But Jesus, on the night before he was going to be crucified, shared a meal with his disciples that we often call the Last Supper. But it wasn't just that he took the bread and the fruit of the vine, but there was a full meal that was involved. And during that meal, Jesus said that in this world, the kings and the great men lorded over their people, but among you it will be different. For I am among you as one who serves. Just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, I now grant you the rights to eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. Jesus is telling a similar story over. You should not fight for your honor. You don't need to be the one who's trying to grasp all this honor for yourselves. That's what the kings of this world do, but that's not how I do it. Look at my example. I come and I serve. But then he says, and you know what I'm doing? Just as my Father has honored me, my Father has given me a kingdom, you know what he's doing to us? He is honoring us. And he says, I'm giving you the right to sit at my table, to eat in my kingdom. And after that, he says, you'll sit on thrones. You'll have this honored place. Know today that whether you feel like it or not, God actually wants to honor you. Yes, he deserves us to honor him, but he wants to honor you. And I don't know, maybe you feel ashamed about something that's happened in your life, or maybe you don't. Maybe you feel like you deserve all the honor you've received. But I hope today you look at him and accept his goodness and his honor of you, and that you'll live your life instead of trying to put yourself in the first place, that you'll serve those who are the least. And be willing to throw parties, just like it said, to invite the crippled, the lame, the blind to your dinners. Who is it that comes to your house? Who is it that you honor? May it be the same people that Jesus honors.